Hi, it's Deepak Bhatt for ACC.org, and I'm here with my close friend, Professor Gabriel Steg from Paris, and we are going to recap a few of the trials today at ESC in Barcelona, where we're having a great time. Actually, we've been really busy. We haven't been having a great time in terms of going out and having fun, but learning a lot about trials, doing good science, I think. And speaking of good science, there really was a lot about LDL lowering here, another bolus of information, for example, about this siRNA compound that is able to reduce LDL by quite a lot and can be administered really quite infrequently. What do you think?
Yeah, that's really fascinating. We've
the Orion program.
Yeah, the Orion program. So we knew about PCSK9 inhibitors, the monoclonal antibodies that you give every 2 weeks or every 4 weeks. And now you have inclisiran, this siRNA for PCSK9, which you might be able to give every 6 months potentially, right, and achieve very, very sustained and very dramatic LDL reduction. And that seems to be feasible, effective, and safe. What we don't know yet is what is the result in terms of clinical outcomes, both for efficacy and safety. So we have a word of caution. But I think it opens up a new avenue of thinking about, have you had your PCSK9 inhibition this semester, Mr. Smith?
Yeah.
You know, it would be a quite an intriguing approach. And to continue on PCSK9 inhibitors, there was another study that I found really interesting here, which was a secondary analysis from Fourier.
Oh, right.
The Fourier trial, looking at patients achieving very low LDL cholesterol levels. Now, we've been wondering for years about the safety of achieving very low LDL cholesterol levels. And in the statin trials, the information we had was reasonably reassuring, but the levels of LDL cholesterol achieved with statins were in the 40s, sometimes in the 30s,
yes,
rarely lower. Now, with PCSK9 inhibition, we're talking about taking patients into teen values and sometimes undetectable values of LDL cholesterol. And there have been reasonable concerns about whether this is safe, both on the cognitive side or liver side, you know, and all sorts of potential problems, cataracts, glucometabolic status, etc. And the analysis that have been shown here and in other studies are actually quite reassuring. And that's really good news, so that we have the ability with PCSK9 inhibition to lower LDL cholesterol dramatically and yet get away with it.
Yep. No, I agree with everything you said. And if you don't mind, I'm actually going to go back to yesterday a little bit. Your comments made me think, you know, it's interesting that we've got this approach now, very low LDL, that seems to reduce ischemic events by a substantial amount. One can argue about cost effectiveness and so forth with PCSK9 inhibitors. But in terms of the mechanisms, you know, the data are very strong. And yesterday in CANTOS, we learned a totally different complementary approach of attacking inflammation, because the drug studied there was an anti-inflammatory. It didn't lower cholesterol levels appreciably and lowered CRP by a lot and reduced cardiovascular events. So it does seem like those are two distinct pathways. Sure, they can be interrelated with some drugs and in some context, but another way. And then the COMPASS trial, which also found lower mortality with an anticoagulant. So lots of different approaches to attacking cardiovascular risk, and at least at a distance, they all seem like they could be complementary.
Yeah, so I think it's exciting both conceptually and for patients. One of the concerns I have is physicians will be overwhelmed with all of these new drugs.
Right, and the cost of all
these
things.
Yeah, because these drugs have costs and they have side effects. And we all know that one of the problems we have in long-term secondary prevention is to convince the patients to remain adherent to therapy, to polypharmacy long-term. And often patients ask us, doctor, can you reduce my meds?
Yep.
And here we have patients who have no complaints, who are feeling fine, and we're going to have to add new therapies, some of which are costly or injectable or may have side effects. So I think it's going to require some risk stratification. It's opening a new question of how can we best identify the ideal candidates for these therapies.
Yeah, the REACH risk score might be the way. No, that's off topic. We were involved with the risk score. But another thing that I thought was really interesting here was just all the discussion about LDL lowering. And you, in fact, are helping lead a trial along with Greg Schwartz. So there is another outcome trial of PCSK9 inhibitors, Odyssey Outcomes.
Yes. So
it's still germinating.
Odyssey is still ongoing. We're hoping to report early next year. We don't exactly know yet when. And this is a PCSK9 monoclonal antibody in patients post-ACS. And it's 18,000 patients large, so it's a fairly large trial, and we have a slightly longer follow-up than in Fourier, which may be important given that it seems that it takes a few months of accrual of therapy for the event curves to diverge in Fourier, at least. So maybe in Odyssey we'll have a longer time to see some benefit emerge, and maybe hopefully an even greater benefit than what we're seeing. So we're anxious to have the results, and all of us are anxious because you're also involved in that trial.
Right.
And I think it's going to help us better understand the future of this class of compounds.
Yeah, so it's exciting at this meeting, all these new approaches to cardiovascular prevention. Yeah, we've got to figure out how will we pay for it, will patients actually do it, so a lot of practical issues, but still it's exciting to be part of this. The final trial, just got to mention in terms of, you know, things that are positive, was the spiral hypertension off med. So that's a renal artery denervation trial looking at patients that are hypertensive but not on meds, sham controlled to renal artery denervation versus sham. And it found a significant reduction, statistically significant reduction, in both ambulatory and office blood pressure when comparing the two arms. A more modest degree of reduction than had been previously reported in unblinded and uncontrolled studies, non-sham controlled, but still proof of concept that in a carefully done study, this more aggressive, more complete renal denervation going into the branches, accessory arteries, better catheter delivering circumferential ablation, it can actually produce a biological effect.
It's interesting to see this the shape of enthusiasm and disillusion of innovation.
Right.
With renal denervation, it was typical. We had this wave of excitement that we have this new interventional therapy for patients with hypertension, resistant hypertension, and then you did the definitive trial that showed that a lot of that effect was sham.
Right.
When you did the first large sham-controlled randomized trial, and then there was disillusion, a lot of people wrote it off, and now we have the concept creeping back up and maybe light at the end of the tunnel. Maybe there's something there. We just have to make it more effective and find who are the best candidates.
Yeah, I think that's the key, finding who are responders, probably tweaking technique even more to try to get a larger, more reproducible effect. But at least it looks like there's something there, and I think that is exciting. So really a bunch of exciting trials. Thank you so much for providing your insights and commentary. Really great to be here in Barcelona, especially after everything that went on in Barcelona last week, just to see so many people here full of positive energy. Hopefully back home you're getting to enjoy our replay of what's going on here.